Very happy to say that we managed to get Doug Kirkpatrick from the Self-Management Institute on the phone. The telephone hamsters between here and Sacramento have finally kicked in. It's probably because it's Sunday morning. And Doug, welcome to you.
Thanks. Good to be here, Nick. Thank you.
I'm so sorry to grab you. It's 6:10 where you are, and I hope the sun's shining and the coffee's strong. Thanks for joining us so bright and early.
Coffee's strong, but it's pitch black outside.
Oh, my God. Okay, well, maybe the sun will possibly rise as we speak. Doug, I know you're at the Self-Management Institute, but am I correct in thinking that you actually did work at Morningstar itself?
Absolutely. I was the financial controller when we started manufacturing operations in 1990. I'd actually worked with the founder, Chris Ruper, at a prior company before that, and followed him to Morningstar in the spring of 1990.
So tell us how this came about. I've just been telling the listeners, Chris was an MBA graduate from UCLA, and he just went into the tomato trucking industry. But what was the intellectual genesis of how he decided to build Morningstar in such a different way?
Well, his history is that he drove a tomato truck to put himself through college. And as he drove his truck into various antiquated factories and operations around the state of California, he would notice better ways to do things. And for example, he would be asked to park his truck for 3 or 4 hours at a time, waiting for logistical support to unload his tomatoes. And he found that that was very frustrating and very inefficient, and he kept identifying better ways to do things. So in the late 1970s, he began putting together a business plan for a better way to process tomatoes, and brought together a group of investors who were farmers, producers of tomatoes, and they put together a company in 1982 and began operations in 1983. That's when I joined him. And it was very technologically advanced, successful company. The manufacturing operations were very successful. There were several innovations that came about. But we always had the nagging feeling that there was a better way to organize. And one of the catalysts for that was that one day he was signing checks, and we had supervisors who would order machinery, and the machinery would arrive, and we'd receive a receiver and an invoice, and supervisors generated these purchases with purchase orders, and he was signing checks, and he said, there's really no reason for me to be signing these checks, because purchase order is a legal liability. It's a legally binding contract. And if I don't sign the check, I'm going to be sued. So I'm adding no value to this process. And we were organized at the time in a very rigid hierarchy with Chris at the top and myself and some other managers below him and then the supervisors and then everyone else. And he said, he brought the checks down to me and said, you sign the checks because, you know, you can watch what's happening with these purchases more closely, and that frees me up to do things that are more strategic. And so we just gained some insights from our pyramidal, hierarchical, organizational structure that led him to think that there was a better way not only to manufacture tomato products, but also to organize the company. And so he went off in 1988, developed the business plan for Morningstar, and we began that project in 1990, and I followed him to Morningstar, and that's when we started Self-Management.
It's an amazing concept, and am I correct in saying that technically speaking, the hierarchy is just one person deep, but it's far more complicated than that really, isn't it? Because between every single individual on the shop floor and elsewhere in the business, there is a process of negotiation that goes on that makes it all work. Is that correct?
Absolutely correct. I mean, the underlying principle, there are two principles. One is people shouldn't use force. That means all transactions are voluntary. And the second one is that everyone should keep their commitment. So if you take the principle of not using force, that means the entire enterprise is governed by complete voluntariness, which means everything is negotiable. So people are hired for certain skills, but in the course of developing their roles, they identify how best to apply those skills to the operation, and they negotiate those roles intensively with their fellow colleagues. And those are dynamic. They can be negotiated and renegotiated at any time because, again, all relationships are voluntary.
But what happens if somebody comes into the business and they're just not predisposed to work like this? I mean, surely it can't work for everybody.
No, it doesn't. Human beings are diverse, and that doesn't work for everyone. I would say the two types of people that it doesn't work for are firstly people that want to be a boss. And most of us grew up in hierarchies, and many of us worked in hierarchies and climbed career ladders. And so sometimes when people come into Morningstar from those environments, it's a challenge for them to adapt. They just want to be able to give orders. And of course, at Morningstar, you can't give orders, and so that doesn't work out. I'd say the other type of individual that faces challenges in self-management is someone who lacks initiative, because self-management depends on massive communication, takes effort on the part of transmitters and receivers of information to communicate effectively in order to get work done. And people that lack initiative tend not to thrive in this environment.
I think what's really extraordinary is that you're talking about an industry which, yes, it has some very technical elements to it, but an awful lot of the work that goes on there is what one would describe as manual labor. And yet, when people, even when they're just doing quality control on a tomato line, for instance, when they're given the freedom to work out how to do their job better, they embrace that freedom wholeheartedly. And I think that's one of the most heartwarming, encouraging things about what you do there.
Yeah, I agree. The engagement levels on the part of seasonal workers are truly astounding. We've had years where we've had 100% return rates on the part of seasonal workers who only work 3.5 months during the summer. So you can tell just from the smiles and the engagement and the camaraderie and the joie de vivre that people are very happy in this environment, regardless of the type of job they're performing.
So how does somebody fired, now on the assumption that I imagine that somebody who comes into the business to be employed is actually interviewed by their future colleagues. Is that correct? It's actually, they're not interviewed by HR or anything. They're interviewed by the people they're going to be working with?
That's correct. They are the people they'll be working with are the decision makers. So electricians hire electricians, mechanics hire mechanics, quality personnel hire quality personnel. Absolutely.
And what happens if, I guess it must happen now and again, what happens if somebody does have to be let go? How does that work?
Well, the principle of not using force means that no one has any unilateral authority to fire anyone. So if someone's not performing or engaged in activities that undermine the mission or principles or have ethical issues of some kind, then it's a process of request and response. So colleagues have an affirmative obligation, perhaps, depending on the facts and circumstances, to request that another colleague exit the company. And sometimes people agree with those requests and say, well, you're right. You know, I'm not doing my job. I need to go do something else. But more often than not, they disagree. In that case, there's a process that's invoked called the gaining agreement process. And the next stage is to bring in a third colleague to mediate the request. in response. And if that works, great. If not, we bring in a panel of 3 to 10 colleagues to discuss and try to resolve the disagreement. And if that doesn't work, it goes to arbitration.
Well, that I mean, it sounds as if a company that is built on the on the sort of deletion of hierarchical bureaucracy, that does sound quite a bureaucratic process, though. I imagine it doesn't happen that often, though.
Doesn't happen that often, but I'd say the one-on-one discussions happen every day, because it's not just about jugular request to ask someone to leave the company, but any request about changes to processes or standard operating procedures or any other type of request, those conversations happen all the time. The third-party mediator, that definitely comes into play when there's a distinct disagreement that can be defined. And occasionally that escalates to the panel of 3 to 10 colleagues, and only rarely does it go to arbitration.
What's been the result for Morningstar in this? What's the outcome in terms of growth compared with your peers in the industry?
Well, Morningstar has never, I'll preface this by saying Morningstar has never had a goal of growth. Growth has just been a natural outcome of excellent execution. So we started literally from zero. We built our first factory in 1990, and we're now the largest tomato processor in the world, over 700 million in sales. I believe everyone in North America has eaten our products, because it goes into everything in the grocery store shelves that you can think of, from ketchup to steak sauce, pizza sauce, spaghetti sauce, taco sauce, and everything else. And we are the largest in our industry.
Does it work for anyone or everyone in any business? I mean, you're now at the Self-Management Institute, which grew out of Morningstar, but you're not actually in the company. You're there to sort of work out the philosophy of self-management and the practicalities of it. Does it work for anyone?
I will say yes, it works for everyone. If you think about self-management, it's the way we all organize our personal lives already. So none of us have a boss that tells us where to go to college, what to study in college, who to date, who to marry, where to live, what to do for a living, whether to buy a house or a car, have children. Somehow we all make those decisions on our own. We are all self-managers. And yet, when we step into the workplace, seemingly, we can't do anything unless we have bosses. And we believe that's a mistaken belief. So we're just trying to bring the way people naturally live their lives already into the workplace.
But if you're going to set out to build a business on this principle, My guess, and I may be entirely wrong, but it takes time to bed a system in that works, where you're effectively saying to a group of individuals, right, you need to find the channels of communication between you. And that takes time, and it could be expensive. Is this why not that many people go in for this structure? They prefer the easily applied hierarchical systems?
Yeah, that's a great question, Nick. I thought about that. And in a sense, it takes time. In a sense, it doesn't. Because when we started Morningstar, basically, we just had one meeting at night. And Chris proposed the two core principles of no force, keep commitments. And we adopted them. And that was in March of 1990. And that really, we really only had 24 people at the time, and that was the foundation of self-management. And that's pretty much the governance of the enterprise until we developed some other tools and support systems about 5 or 6 years later. So we were able to run for a considerable period of time on extremely simple principles which govern quite a bit of complexity. And I think that same philosophy applies to any organization. It's been amazing to see the diversity of organizations who are interested in self-management. And, you know, people often have objections. Skeptics will say, well, it couldn't work in this industry, or it couldn't scale to this size, or, you know, it wouldn't work with these types of people. But I just point out the complexity of the issues that Morningstar grapples with to deal with the type of industry. And I point to the fact that we grew from zero to the size that we are today to deal with the scale issues. And it's really seems to be universal, because interest in this is springing up from all across the USA and all around the world.
It does seem odd, given that America has a reputation for, American companies have a reputation for being quite tough. They actually, there are not a lot of employee rights as they're defined in the UK and in the European Union. And it's very much a feeling that the workforces are pretty much there at the disposal and pleasure of the management. It's quite extraordinary that it's happened in this way. And I wondered if you can comment on that, and also comment on just what do you think in terms of society we'd look like if more companies adopted your self-management style?
Right. I'll preface that by saying more companies are adopting our self-management style, because it is the way that people naturally live their lives. And people are engaged and happy in self-management. Once they taste it and experience it, they don't want to go back. And so when you have people that have the kinds of freedom and autonomy the people at Morningstar experience, they don't go back. Their retention rates are sky high. And the other great thing is that it really permeates their entire lives, their civic lives, their community lives, their work lives, their personal lives, everywhere else. Because if you internalize the principles of not using force and keeping commitments, that's a great benefit to the entirety of an individual's life.
Well, Doug, it's been a tremendous pleasure talking to you today. Thank you very much for telling us about it. Anybody who wants to learn more about what Doug Kirkpatrick and the Self-Management Institute do, do go online. It's very self-explanatory. Just, you know, Google Self-Management Institute, Doug Kirkpatrick, and or Morningstar, and you'll receive a wealth of information. Doug, thank you again. Have a great day, and best wishes from London. Good afternoon to you. This is the shop floor on Share Radio this rather grim Sunday afternoon. My name's Nick Peters. The time's 2:32. In the last half hour, we were talking about self-management with Doug Kirkpatrick of the Self-Management Institute. And he was telling us about the rather extraordinary way they operate in California. Now, listening to that was Craig Preston from the Inspirational Development Group. And Craig, perhaps you could tell us a little bit. First of all, good afternoon to you. But can you tell us just a little bit about what the Inspirational Development Group does, and why you think, and what you think, should I say, of what you heard from Doug Kirkpatrick?
Yeah, good afternoon, Nick. It was a fascinating half hour listening to Doug. You know, it's one where I think a lot of people, when they hear that, will feel, what a wonderful organization. How can I get to work with somebody like that? But of course, reality is a little bit different. Perhaps we'll talk a little bit about that shortly. Yeah, IDG, as Inspirational Development Group is known, is a business that looks at trying to change organizational behavior in order to improve business performance. We focus on the leadership of organizations, and indeed we call the followership of the organization. And together, from leaders and followers, changing behavior appropriately should improve performance. And funnily enough, some of the stuff that Doug was talking about is very much an objective of what we do and a lot of organizations like us in trying to help businesses. My initial thoughts on the case study, which is a very powerful one, clearly, because this is an organization that's become extremely successful over time, is, as you said, if it is that good, why have there have not been a large number of other businesses, not only in that sector, but across other sectors and geographies, managed to achieve what they have? What struck me initially was that it was founded and operated in a certain way for a while until 1990, when a new model was put together. But buying into that model in what was then a much smaller business is an easier thing to try and control as the overall CEO of that business than it is if you're trying to change the culture and the way of working in an organization that's already established, very structured, maybe very highly organized and hierarchical, and one that's actually delivering fairly good results right now. So trying to change those is far more difficult than building it from the start. But I must admit, I'd love to have the chance to do something like that.
Yeah, quite. I thought one of the really intriguing things he said was that it's not suitable for anybody who wants to be a boss. And what's fascinating about life as we live it generally in the business world is that an awful lot of people do want to be bosses, or think they do. They may not necessarily know why they want to be a boss, but they just have that feeling that if they can't be a boss, they don't want to be bossed, if I can put it that way. Why do you think people want to be above others and to boss them about?
Well, I think... No, it's an interesting one. I mean, my own background is for the first 18 years of my working life, I was an army officer, and went through Sandhurst as a cadet. Funnily enough, our IDG have a partnership with Sandhurst, and we do quite a lot of leadership development for business at the academy, or looking at the very values-based approach that the military use. And what the British approach would suggest is that it's not always the same around the world, but leaders, those that want to be leaders, there's an awful lot of nature in that they're not necessarily just clearly born, but their potential to lead and willingness and desire to lead is something that's innate. Where I think people like that will have a problem is if you do have, and quote Montgomery's definition of leadership, which is the will to dominate with the character that inspires confidence. If you're that sort of person that naturally likes to take responsibility for and be accountable for collective performance, yeah, working in Morningstar will be a real challenge, because you're spending an awful lot of time, quite rightly in that culture, learning to and being able to collaborate without necessarily at times being able to dominate, often in a way that other people wish you to. So it is a challenge for those people who innately want to lead and want to be responsible for other people, to operate in one where they can't be.
Yeah, I that's interesting the way you described all of that, because if somebody's a leader or has that sort of that desire about them, then if we're talking transactions, and I guess we are talking transactions, unlike Morningstar, where it's a collaborative transaction, this is what I'm giving, this is what I want, the leadership-led transaction is, I am actually going to take from you a great deal of the responsibility for the success or failure of this. In return for that, I want your unquestioning support. You have to do as I say. So they're both transactions, but of a very different nature. One's vertical, one's horizontal.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that effective leaders are ones that will have built respect and trust with those around them at peer level and those who are supposedly working with and for them, so that when they do make a decision on others' behalf, the other people will follow. And there are good reasons for it happening. I mean, the collaborative approach that Doug was talking about is one where everyone feels they've got some ownership. Everyone will feel that they are accountable for the performance. But when haste is really needed, when a decision is made very quickly, needed very quickly, you may well have a number of differing views. Somebody has got to be able to say, well, I tell you what, I've heard all of the different views. Actually, most of them are workable. But in everyone's interest, we need to move quickly. So let's go with option B. It's then the responsibility for everybody around them to make that call the right call, because it's in no one's interest for it to fail.
I think. So, go on.
No, that's, so it's it, at times I can see circumstances where that lack of hierarchy, whilst it might increase or some autonomy and authority, might slow down the process.
I get it, yes, so that it, particularly in an army environment, for instance, but what I think, and I know what you're going to say about this, what's fascinating is if you look at a lot of studies around particularly the SAS and very tight units of men in very high-stress environments, that actually classlessness, lack of hierarchy, is a requirement for what they do. It is not a sort of top-down structure, as some might expect.
No, I would agree, and I think that perhaps it's better to say that actually, whether we call it hierarchy or not, and you're absolutely right, the classless thing is in high-performing teams, high-performing organisations, is something that shouldn't be there. However, ultimately, somebody might be the one that needs to make a decision. And that can be at any particular place within a team. So, you know, whether it's hierarchical or not, there'll be a subject matter expert in a group for whom you may well defer for that decision. I think the best examples, whether that's in the military or in business or indeed in sport, are ones where trust, mutual respect and the ability to make decisions are spread as widely as they can, but ultimately we know who can. The All Blacks, for example, within rugby, would say that they have a very, what we call a leader-full culture, where you know, anyone can make a decision because everyone's a leader and everyone's a follower. And, you know, that reflects reflects high performance in a group that, and here's the thing I suppose that's important here, have a common set of values, know each other extremely well over time, know each other's strengths and weaknesses, and are happy to make decisions and take responsibility for everybody else because they respect them. And indeed, as Doug was talking before, because they all share and buy into the same mission.
Yeah, that word mission is so important, because none of that would work ever if the mission was set remotely by a third party and they said, right, this is the mission, now you work out how to make it happen. Everybody's got to agree the mission. So that sense of ownership is it's about the outcome, not just the process.
Oh, absolutely. And I think the best organizations are ones that are able to measure outputs, not inputs. And the outputs are completely aligned with an overall mission, which, as you say, is one at its best where everyone's had an input into, and it's not been directed from the top down.
So, you know, it's funny when we talk about these, I suppose, it's partly idealistic, actually. But how do we get more people, he said, acting like an evangelist, how do we get more people to think like this? Because it is very clear from what Doug said and from what anything you read about environments where people have total buy-in to process and outcomes and work together to achieve both and to the maximum capacity. How do we get more people to buy into that and to spread the word? Because societally, it's got to be an improvement.
Absolutely. I think Doug mentioned that one of the features of the of the way they operate is that it working in the business that way reflects how people work outside the business in their own life, in terms of being able to make their own decisions, make their own choices, decide how much they're going to spend on projects, and I think he said, you know, which college they go to, etc. And I think in a number of cultures, that's absolutely right. There are, however, a number of parts of the world where that's not the case. And a lot of that is directed for them. And large global organizations will have a mix of businesses in countries where that type of culture is workable. But also, and we do work in you know, parts of the Far East and the Middle East and so on, where that sort of culture really would be tough to get across, because it doesn't reflect how people live outside of work. So I think it's a it's a good call, because, you know, I listened to Doug thinking, well, you know, how could I get that into my organisation? And I think it's tough because of. And I think if it was that easy, obviously there'd be far more organisations that already look like that. But it's tough because people do have expectations which vary. People, whether we like it or not, have different drivers in terms of what makes them tick. There are people who are very status conscious, who don't. It's not just about authority. It's about you know, where I sit amongst my peers, having a progression and so on. And whilst we might say it's not necessarily the best approach, in most organisations, a large number of key people do have that as a key driver. As I was reflecting on it, I thought, well, you know, if you took a multinational, global organisation, whether that's a large insurance broker or a bank or whatever, and said, right, we're going to try and tackle that in here to across the whole organization, you have a mix of not just the hierarchy, but and a lot of these large businesses acquired other businesses with utterly different cultures and ways of doing things, different financial models, different histories, different values. It would be a massive project, a wonderful one to undertake, but a massive project nonetheless. And in a world where we are hugely short-term driven these days, you're measured on your last quarter or your next quarter or the year, and bonuses and progression are reliant on how you perform within those short periods of time. Turning around to the workforce, the shareholders, your customers and so on, and saying, let's take a few years out here, guys. We're going to unpack the business, put it back together again very slowly, and there'll be a lot of casualties in all of this. Hang in there. I think it's a tough message. So I think working in the real world, I'd love to think we could inculcate a number of the key components of what Doug and the Morningstar are doing. Trying to replicate it is that difficult. We're seeing it today, and that there aren't many other organizations like that out there.
Yeah, just one I should mention is W.L. Gore. Do you know that company? They make the Gore-Tex fabric, that waterproof clothing.
Yes, I do know them, yes.
Yeah. And they apparently, I haven't studied them, I haven't done a lot of reading about them, but they apparently have very much self-management at their heart. But if I can just go back to what you said, given you're quite right, it's like saying, you know, peace, motherhood, and apple pie, let's let the world rejoice. We're all going to change. It's not going to happen. It must be possible, however, to take some of these principles, even at the micro level, and introduce them in small teams and definitely in small businesses, I would have thought. Anybody starting a business today should very much think along these lines.
I agree. I think it's you know, the case studies we're talking about are ones where this culture was embedded at an early stage in their development. It also, I may not be accurate here, but it seems to me that those that have grown organically, not necessarily by acquisition as well, where you would then have an extra challenge of trying to turn around or change the culture of a business that operated very differently for some time. But if I was to say, well, so which bits are applicable in other organisations. I would suggest the whole mission focus is one that is very very powerful, and I think can be applied across. I think it's crucial that the mission is understood at different levels. So if you're to work autonomously at one level, being able to understand the mission at yours, and let's assume we are in a hierarchical business of sorts anyway, at least one, maybe two levels up, then you're able to make decisions at different parts of that organization in a very aligned fashion. Perversely, and I talked about the military approach earlier, one of the best examples of mission-orientated business is seen in a lot of the Western armies these days. They call it mission command, and essentially what we're asking people to do is to understand the intent of the next level up, probably the next two levels up, and then within your own area of responsibility, you are very clear about what your restrictions are in terms of, and let's talk business here, budget, timeline, resources, key relationships, and so on. But within those constraints, over to you. You can make your decision as you wish and operate exactly the way you wish. Make your own improvements, make decisions about what your priorities are, but they must be in line with the intent of the next level up. Just to finish up, funnily enough, that was developed initially by the Germans at the end of the Second World War. And it's one that the British, the Americans and others have developed over the last 20, 30 years. But very, very effective when used in business.
So tell us something about what the IDG, the Inspirational Development Group, does, and how a lot of what we've been just discussing aligns with your mission in the world of business, and where you actually do your business and who for.
Okay, well, IDG's clients are in a number of different sectors. I suppose the majority of our work is financial services. But so we do work with banks and the insurance world, as well as much wider, including professional sport and elsewhere. But the our approach is really to say it's fundamentally about improving performance. So it's not training development in the classic way. It's really establishing what the strategic objectives of a business are. And understanding how by improving the culture, leadership, and followership in the business, you can improve that business performance. So in a lot of ways, it is very similar to what the Morningstar case study looks like, but we acknowledge that we're never going to turn it into the perfect organization. We are going to improve performance, though. And so it's about behavioral change, and that can be very much, I think one of the key things to this is employing a values-based approach, and that very much is in line with Doug and what he's trying to do, to try and get people to operate with a similar set of values, principles, and behaviours.
The last thing I want to do is to sort of beat the old bankers and whatnot's drum, but the fact of the matter is, it strikes me from the outside that an awful lot of what went wrong inside some of the banks and some of the financial institutions was actually a breakdown of those values. Is that fair to say?
I think it's very fair to say, and I don't think you'd find many people within that sector, or indeed the clients we work with, who would disagree with you. I think that the values approach is one that provides individuals and the business as a whole with a moral compass. So around that, you can have huge changes in regulation, changes in technology, changes in the economic environment. But at the core is our leadership and a community that lives and breathes the same set of values, and that allows you to be adaptable and flexible, but not change at your own core. I think it's been a tough old time, but I do think that, from our discussions with with the financial sector now, there's a real recognition that, that a values-based approach has to be at the core of everything they do.
You mentioned a few minutes ago about short-termism. I think it was in the 70s, and again stemming from America, where the concept of a business having a multi-layered and multi-level relationship with the people who work for it, the community in which it works, its customers, its suppliers, everybody, gradually gave way to a new hierarchy of expectation, which was that the shareholders are the number one, and the performance of the share price in the short term became paramount. And that, of course, led, as we know, to bringing in the leaders who can achieve that, and therefore you got these ridiculous pay awards, etc., etc., which leads us to where we are now. So it's not just a question of changing, you know, day-to-day values. There is actually a massive structural macro challenge in all of this for everybody.
Absolutely. I think at the core of it is what organizations are measured on. And you're right, you know, that the obsession has been sharing the value, the share price, etc., which is, if you work on the principle, what gets measured gets done. As soon as you're focusing on that, behaviors will represent what's needed to improve that. And I think that the values and ethics, work ethics of the financial sector for a while got blurred hugely by what they were being measured on. And that measurement in the short term, if you recognise that the lifespan, the typical lifespan of a CEO of a FTSE 200 company is about 18 months, you know, they've got a challenge of trying to put together a long-term strategy which provides a legacy and a longevity to the business with the short-term expectations. And if they don't balance them both, and in particular deliver in the short term, then their life expectancy will be very, very short. It's a tough one. And I do think, however, that there's been a significant shift over the last 6 months, a year or so.
One point I think we should just reinforce, we're coming towards the end of our time, but one thing we should reinforce is that an awful lot of what we've been talking about and what Doug was talking about earlier from Sacramento sounds pretty idealistic, it sounds a little bit loosey-goosey and all of that. But the fact of the matter is that it actually makes businesses more efficient and more profitable, because anything that eases the friction that's created by hierarchical bureaucracy is going to make things work better. Now, I just want to leave on that point. Is that something you'd agree with?
Yeah, I would. It's an interesting book. John Cotter, who obviously wrote the book Leading Change, his latest one called Accelerate, talks about having a blend of both hierarchy and matrix groupings within a business in order to deal with the reality of operating on a day-to-day basis, but also being able to be innovative, ingenious, and to take big opportunities that might be out there. And I think in reality there's a blend of both, if I'm honest, Nick. I think it's in order to sustain business as usual, unless you're starting the business from scratch, some form of hierarchy is inevitable. But having other ways of developing ideas, culture, communication within the organization is important if you're going to give people, as Doug would say, that sense of engagement and a will to be part of the organization and work for it that goes just beyond the salary and status.
Well, it's as I say, a little bit idealistic to at first blush, but by heavens, some more of this spread through business would perhaps make life more fun for everybody involved and definitely more profitable. Craig, thank you so much for joining us. I really appreciate your time.
Not at all. You're very welcome.
Thank you. That's, pardon me, Craig Preston, who's Managing Director of the Inspirational Development.